Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. In this podcast, we are going to learn about acetic acid as given in Borix Materia Medica. So let's get started. Acetic acid, under which it's also given as, is commonly called as glacial acetic acid. So yeah, this drug produces a condition of profound anemia with some dropsical symptoms, great debility, frequent fainting, dyspnea, weak heart, vomiting, profuse urination and sweat. So going through this introduction symptoms, we get an idea that there is a profound anemia in patients wherein acetic acid is suitable. Long running anemia results in the following symptoms. Anemia results in the generalized dropsy due to the escape of the interstitial fluid in between the cells, and which results in the pitting edema, and there is great debility as there is decreased oxygen supply due to the decreased RBC that is carrying oxygen, and there is frequent fainting that is explanatory as such, dyspnea, weak heart, vomiting and profuse urination and sweat. So these are the symptoms found in the patients where acetic acid is found to be helpful. And there is hemorrhage from any part. This is a very important symptom in acetic acid. There is excessive hemorrhage from any part of the body, and especially it is indicated in pale, lean persons with lax and flabby muscles. So you can get a picture where there is long-running anemia in a patient due to an history of long-running hemorrhages in any sort of, from any surface in the body, and which resulting in the excessive weakness of the patient, resulting in very lean, thin, emaciated body. In such patients, you can think in any diseases or any symptomatic conditions wherein these constitutional presentation is observed, acetic acid is helpful. And next comes wasting and debility, which is given in italics, which is a very, very important symptom. Wasting and debility actually point towards the acetic acid usage. Acetic acid has the power to liquefy albuminous and fibrinous deposits. It's a very important point because it's given in italics. It is helpful in the liquefaction of albuminous deposits, which can be thought of in albumin is nothing but a protein thing. So it can, if interpreted properly, it can be think of in gouty subjects as such, and fibrinous deposits you can think of in polyps, you can think in uterine polyps, fibroids, etc., wherein there is a situation and tendency of fibrinous overgrowths. You can think of acetic acid in such conditions when the patient have excessive anemia, dropsy, fainting, weakness, etc. And also in, it's given also in epithelial cancer internally and locally by some W. Owens, so it may be a proven symptom. And yeah, psychosis with nodules and formation in the joints, as I have said previously. So any local deposition of nodules and formation in the joints, you can think of acetic acid. Heart chancre, the 1x solution will soften and cause formation of pus. So maybe that is a crude usage of acetic acid, but I've never come across such local usage of acetic acid externally. So yeah, coming to the very particular symptoms. So yeah, I would like to give a small gist after the completion of introduction. So from the introduction, we extracted that acetic acid is a remedy to be thought of when there is long-running anemia in the patient, there is a dropsy in the patient, frequent fainting in the patient, weakness, debility, and hemorrhages from any part of the body. So in such conditions, you can think of acetic acid. Next comes, it has a power to also liquefy albuminous and fibrinous deposits anywhere in the body. So how that can be interpreted in various ways. I'm giving some examples as such in gout, acidogens in uterine polyps, uterine fibroids, and nasal polyps also you can think of. And maybe you can think of adenoid hypertrophy, and you can think of tonsillar inflammation too, if symptoms correspond. That is a very important thing. Yeah, if symptoms correspond, that is hemorrhages, debility, as well as anemia. Next comes the mind irritable, worried about business affairs. That is a very vague symptom which you can't correlate as such. So I'm not gonna go deeper into that symptom. So yeah, under the mind section, the symptoms are irritable, worried about business affairs. Coming to the head, there is nervous headache from abuse of narcotics. Blood rushes to head with delirium. Temporal vessels distended. Pain across the root of tongue. So, as we have studied in the introduction, there is a tendency for hemorrhage and also anemia. So, the nervous headaches from abuse of narcotics, blood rushes to head with delirium, which can be explained in some situations like anemia. There is low BP, but in conditions when there is headache, when there is excessive demand in certain organ, blood rushes to that area. So, it can be explained in such a way, it can be interpreted in such a way. And there is delirium and the temporal vessels are distended, which gives you a picture of if you just imagine how a headache, when you can actually visualize temporal vessels are distended, you can think of acetic acid when the symptoms correspond. And coming to the face, the pale is waxen emaciated due to the long running anemia and hemorrhages as such. The eyes are sunken, surrounded by dark rings, which is a typical anemic expression. Bright red, which is not a typical anemic expression, but you can see in some cases there will be false plethora. That is why false, actually plethora means redness, you know, which actually make you to think that patient is having good amount of blood in the body, but actually it isn't justifiable. That's why it's called as false plethora. So you can expect some sort of false plethora in some cases of acetic acid. And they are sweaty. Epithelioma of lip, as I've already said, there is a tendency for psychosis, psychotic tendency, and fibrinous and albuminous deposits as such. Cheeks are hot and flushed, and aching in the left jaw point. These are some common symptoms. And next comes stomach. There is excessive salivation, fermentation in the stomach, intense burning thirst, cold drinks, distress, vomits after every kind of food. There is epigastric tenderness, burning pain as of an ulcer, cancer of stomach, sour belching and vomiting, burning water brash and profuse salivation. So next, at the end comes exact point. These all symptoms can be seen in hyperchlorhydria and gastralgia. So in symptoms wherein there are excessive expression of water brash, epigastric burning along the esophagus, you can have excessive salivation. Patients say that they have this hot water in their mouth after they eat. There are belchings, etc., which is the commonest presentation of hyperchlorhydria and gastralgia. These are the commonest presentation in the gastritis, but it is also given it can be used in the cancers of stomach as such. So yeah, in cancers too, following ulcerations, you can see there will be hemorrhage and interpreted in that way. So you can employ acetic acid in such cases. And the italics important symptom is violent burning pain in stomach and chest, followed by coldness of skin and cold sweat on the forehead, which is explanatory of some sympathetic trigger. So yeah, in acute conditions wherein the patient feel immediately they'll be having cold sweat and they'll be having water brush, they'll be like burning everything. These are seen in acute action of hyperchlorhydria. So acetic acid, when we given with some good result and good relief, stomach feels as if she had taken a lot of vinegar. So that's a subjective symptom. Okay, so abdomen feels as if abdomen was sinking in, frequent watery stools, worse in the morning, tympanitic, ascites, hemorrhage from bowels. So we have already seen there is a frequent tendency for hemorrhages as such. And there is excessive belchings and excessive flatulent formation as such because of the depletion in the, you know, there is hyperchlorhydria as such and depletion in the digestive capacity, which can be manifested in many ways, whereas acetic acid is suitable in such cases where there is tympanitic, there is excessive formation of gas. And also there is ascites is given, which can be interpreted in such way because in the beginning it is given as such, there will be dropsy as such. So dropsy, ascites is nothing but a kind of accumulation of fluid in the peritoneum. So that may be secondary to any sort of localized infection as such, or there may be it is seen in many cases. Ascites is a commonest presentation in the very many diseases accompanying the dysfunction of stomach, intestines, etc. So as I've already said, there is dropsy, so that can be interpreted in such a way. There will be ascites in the abdomen. And coming to the urine, there are large quantities of pale urine, diabetes with great thirst and debility. So yeah, this is the one of the common, one of the important symptoms. So when interpreted pathologically, the symptoms of astic acid are very much like that in, seen in diabetes. There is excessive thirst, excessive pale urination, and also great debility is seen as such. So acetic acid can be prescribed in patients with the given symptoms who are existing diabetics with very good results. And coming to the female, there is excessive catamenia, which can be interpreted excessive bleeding during the menses, and hemorrhages after labor. So hemorrhage is one of the key point in the acetic acid. And the nausea of pregnancy, breasts are painfully enlarged, distended with milk, milk impoverished, bluish transparent sour, anemia of nursing mother. So in acetic acid, the anemia is commonest presentation. So you can think of usage of acetic acid in the anemia of nursing mothers too. Coming to the respiratory, there is hoarse, hissing respiration, there is difficulty in breathing, there is cough when inhaling, membranous croup. Croup is tracheobronchial laryngitis. There is involvement of both upper and lower, a part of upper and lower respiratory tract involvement. Its infection is called as croup. So irritation of trachea and bronchial tube is seen, and there is false membrane in throat, profuse bronchorrhea, putrid sore throat. So it can be thought of in upper respiratory tract infections as such. And when there is excessive hissing respiration, difficulty in breathing, and putridity as such. Coming to the back, there is pain in back relieved only lying on abdomen. Here is a simple point you need to remember, which is very important in case of academic interest. Acetic acid has a very important modality. The distension of abdomen or something like that is better when they are lying on the abdomen, but actually when observed, people who are having belching or distension in whatsoever, they can't lie on their abdomen, they have to lie to the sides. But in acetic acid, contrarily, they get some relief when they lie on their abdomen, which becomes a very common modality or any particular or peculiar modality. If you have any patient with such modality, you can without any second doubt go out with the usage of acetic acid. Coming to the extremities, there is emaciation, edema of feet and legs. As I already said, there is emaciation due to the decreased ability of or decrease in the number of RBC carrying oxygen. So the nutrition is in depletion as such, and due to which there is not a very good development of the musculature or the nutritive plane, so that the development is good. So there is emaciation and the edema on feet and legs, that is common in anemia as such. Coming to the skin, it's pale, waxen and edematous, that's explanatory as such. Burning, dry, hot skin or bathed in profuse sweat. The repeated sweating is a common symptom found in acetic acid. We had already heard about that, when they have this hyperchlorhydria, there will be drenching of cold sweat as such. So the sweating is a common symptom, very commonly observed in acetic acid. Diminished sensibility of surface of the body, useful after stings, bites, etc. Varicose swelling, scurvy, anasarca, that is generalized edema, bruises and sprains. So the important thing is it's also useful after stings and bites, etc. And also varicose swellings, maybe it can be as they already said, it is useful to liquefy fibrinous deposits. We can interpret it in such way, it can maybe shrunk in the fibrinous thing. So in the over the varicose swellings, if we apply externally, maybe it can have some effect. Well, that's what he means to say. Or internally, it may have some effect in the varicose swellings of the person. Coming to the fever, it is very much hectic with drenching night sweats, red spot on left cheek, no thirst in fever, ebullitions, sweat is profuse and cold. Maybe cold sweat is a very, very keynote symptom in acetic acid. So yeah, that brings us to the end of the acetic acid explanation according to Borix Materia Medica. So I have tried my best so that I can put into the simple words the very much complicated description given in the Borix Materia Medica. It is actually a bit boring because you don't understand exactly what he's trying to explain. But as you pass out of the, you know, you have just completed your graduation, you'll be in a point of time, you know, it's a point of time where you have the knowledge of medicine, gynecology, all sorts of all sorts of normal physiology, anatomy, as well as diseased physiology and anatomy. So you can put yourself in a proper place where you can exactly understand Materia Medica as such. So that gives the people who complete a graduation a bit more edge than the people who are actually studying Materia Medica in their as a part of the syllabus still in the graduation. So I just recommend to just listen to this podcast, go out and read for yourself, just a normal reading, or just give a normal reading and then listen to this podcast, which gives you an exact understanding what the author is trying to explain, and you can get an idea of exact practical explanation and have your own vision while reading the remedy. While you read, I read a line twice so that it imprints in your mind, and just think over it what it could mean for you, what you think it to be. Just analyze and interpret, and if you have any doubts, you can look up to your teachers who can help you. So that gives you a proper understanding of the remedy. So yeah. Hope I was successful in providing some knowledge and some helpful in, and my podcast was helpful in decoding the Borix Materia Medica acetic acid drug. So thanks a lot for listening to this podcast. I hope you have a good time and great time listening to this to my podcast, and also learning, and have a great time healing using homeopathy. Have a great day. Bye bye.